What if I told you that developing a new drug to treat disease can take 12 to 15 years and up to $2 billion? This is the financial and time burden associated with taking a drug from an idea to something that a doctor can actually administer to a patient. And beyond those drugs that actually make it to the marketplace, we see that 90% of all drugs that enter clinical trials fail to get to that market. For some context, in North America, we are spending more than $60 billion on failed clinical trials every year, just in cancer. And I also need to talk about the ethical considerations of using animals to develop drugs. The FDA estimates that we consume over 115 million animals every year developing new drugs. That is the equivalent to consuming 3 times the entire population of Canada developing new drugs that will likely fail in clinical trials anyways. While animals are currently the best platform that we have, from everything I've told you, it's clear they are not very effective at predicting human behavior when treating disease. Everything I've told you to this point is meant to highlight that developing a new drug is difficult, is time-consuming, and is costly. And we haven't even addressed some of the major issues in the pharmaceutical industry today, like rising costs in clinical trials, the rise of generics companies, and through government regulation, decreased patent protection periods. It leads some experts to actually ask the question, is there a long-term viable future in the pharmaceutical industry? But, as we humans do so well, what if we could innovate our way out of this position? What if we could build a platform that could so accurately capture the complexity of disease that we could identify those drugs that will fail in clinical trials before they ever touch an animal or a human? A platform that could even help doctors make more informed decisions on how to treat patients on an individual basis. A platform that could even repair and regenerate damaged tissue directly in the body. What if we could reimagine the way we develop drugs and the way we treat patients? For the last 3 years, I've worked with an incredibly talented team. We have built the technology to address a lot of these issues in the pharmaceutical industry. And this has led to partnerships with these companies to understand its pain points and its needs for innovation. From this, I imagine a world where the consumption of 115 million animals a year is unacceptable. I imagine a world where the likelihood of success in a clinical trial is way higher than 10%, making medicines more affordable and accessible for patients. We have the technology, and we can apply a revolutionary technology to an antiquated system that has not evolved far in decades. In truth, I imagine a world where we can print the solutions. Since the turn of the century, with the evolution of 3D printing came 3D bioprinting, which is exactly what it sounds like, to construct natural, tissue-like, three-dimensional structures by combining cells and biological polymers we call bioinks. 3D bioprinting creates a layer-by-layer approach to recapturing the complexity of human tissue directly in the lab. There are multiple different techniques in 3D bioprinting. To simplify, I'm going to talk about them as high-resolution and low-resolution 3D bioprinting. High-resolution 3D bioprinting uses a high-powered laser source to selectively print areas in a bioink capable of making structures less than 1 micrometer in size, or 1/1000th of a millimeter. We can use this technology to create small snapshots of disease in the lab, but the drawback is the size of the tissues we can create tend to be quite small, about 1 to 2 millimeters. Whereas low-resolution 3D bioprinting cannot create the level of detail that high-resolution techniques can, but the size of the structures we can create are much larger on the centimeter scale, which makes it better for modeling larger tissues or even small organ systems. The decision that scientists make between these techniques is a decision between use case and scale. But 3D bioprinting has the ability to change the way we approach problems in the pharmaceutical industry in three areas right now: drug development, personalized treatment, and regenerative medicine. In drug development, we can use advancements in high-resolution 3D bioprinting to recreate small snapshots of disease in the lab. Right here in our own lab, we can model tissue models that have capillary-sized blood vessels in them, or the smallest blood vessel in your body that is about 5 to 10 times smaller than a single strand of hair. These vascular structures can be used as a delivery system for drugs to disease tissue exactly as it happens in the body. We then have the ability to analyze a realistic piece of diseased human tissue as if we are treating the disease in the body. This can do wonders for identifying those drugs that will fail in clinical trials before they ever get there, de-risking that step. But what about the impact on animals? Well, if we're identifying those drugs that will fail earlier, less drugs move forward to actually being tested on animals. But it does not eliminate the need for them altogether. However, the evolution of this technology will allow us not only to recreate small snapshots of disease in the lab, but also recreate small pieces of healthy tissues and healthy organs. A single platform that will allow us to study a drug on both the diseased tissue and the healthy tissue, allowing scientists to get the data they need on efficacy, which is, does the drug actually treat the disease? And safety, which is there any funny business going on somewhere else in the body we weren't expecting? This change can actually push drug development into a space where we no longer require the use of animals to develop a drug for patients. And this transition is already being endorsed through government regulation. The FDA Modernization Act 2.0, passed in 2022, removed the requirement of testing a drug on an animal to take it into a clinical trial. So we know this future is coming, and we know it is possible. In personalized medicine or personalized treatment, we can apply the exact same high-resolution 3D bioprinting technology to help doctors make better decisions to treat individual patients. We as scientists know that no two diseases are exactly the same. If we imagine two women who have been diagnosed with triple-negative breast cancer, we know it is likely that they will not respond the same to the same treatment. So what if we could take a piece of that disease, a small biopsy sample, and recreate it directly in the lab? We could then work with doctors to screen all available treatment options to make decisions on which treatments work best for each individual patient. And finally, a newer form of therapy, which is regenerative medicine. Using the low-resolution 3D bioprinting technology, we can now create larger constructs that we can actually implant into patients. We can generate specialized regenerative cells that are capable of regulating disease or even healing damaged tissue. For example, type 1 diabetes. Over 120 million people around the world suffer from this disease. We are working on the technology to 3D print specialized regenerative cells directly into a construct that can then be implanted into the patient. That implant can both regulate and monitor a patient's blood sugar level without the administration of any other drugs. This technology can also be adapted to repair damaged hearts or livers or lungs. So what's next? To this point, I have talked about how 3D bioprinting can change the way we develop drugs, can make clinical trials less risky, and can ease the burden of testing drugs on animals. But what if we could take it further? What if we could move beyond tissues and address full organs? This is one of the major ideas behind 3D bioprinting. So how does it work? Well, I imagine that we could combine the technologies I have already talked about for regenerative medicine and drug development to recreate an entire organ directly in the lab. In 2022, nearly 45,000 organ transplants occurred in North America. And it's estimated that in the US, 17 people die every single day waiting for an organ transplant. If you find yourself on the National Organ Transplant List, you can be waiting up to 5 years, depending on the organ you are looking for. The dream in 3D bioprinting is what if we could recreate a patient's entire organ directly in the lab in an afternoon? So the question becomes, is this possible? The short answer is yes. The real answer is slightly muddy and convoluted. As it currently stands, no single 3D bioprinting technology can recreate an entire organ. It is just too complex. But we can model smaller organs in the lab, and we can create tissues like heart tissue that can even have a pulse. So we know it's possible. I imagine that if we combined the technologies from high-resolution and low-resolution 3D bioprinting, we could recreate an entire organ directly in the lab. With low-resolution 3D bioprinting creating the scaffolding and the structure of the organ, while high-resolution 3D bioprinting fills in the gaps and the tiny details. It feels like we are on the precipice of an innovative step of combining these two technologies into a single instrument. The ability to recreate a heart or a lung or even a liver is within our grasp. The ability for 3D bioprinting to not only change the way we develop drugs, but also change the way we approach organ failure and organ rejections. What I want you to take away from today is that we as a society should not accept a 90% failure rate in clinical trials. We can do better, and we can supply medicines that are more affordable and accessible for patients to live longer, stronger, and healthier lives. I know we have the solutions. We're building them right here in our own city, and we can apply this technology to a reasonably antiquated system that has accepted inefficiency because there was nothing that would allow them to do better. Moving forward, I do believe that 3D bioprinting can even move beyond revolutionizing drug development and address the problems we have in organ failure and organ transplants. It's here. The fundamentals of the future have been built. We need a continued collaborative effort between governments, academia, and industry, and sometimes innovation needs a little push from society. So let's push for better outcomes together. Thank you.